Well, good afternoon, and welcome back to North Star Oasis. I'm your host, Jeff Williams. If you are a first-time viewer, we want to welcome you to the show. If you're a regular viewer, we just want to remind you that all of our episodes are on YouTube, youtube.com/NorthStarOasis. And please take a moment, if you like the content that we give you, to check up our Facebook updates at facebook.com/NorthStarOasis. And today we have another jam-packed episode, as we do every week. We go through a whole week of show prep just to give you this 1 hour of content. And today, of course, it's kind of hard to not pay any attention to what happened in Paris. It is extremely difficult. It's been all over the news. You literally have to be living in the woods in Montana in a little red log cabin if you're not tuned into what happened in Paris. And we're really not going to get into the discussion today of what happened in Paris because the situation is still fluid. We're still getting information. The assessments are still being made. But we do want to bring you one little video just as our tribute of solidarity with those in France. And the Eiffel Tower went dark. And exactly what our producers are doing, I don't know. Or if it was just the video. But the Eiffel Tower went dark. And they did the same thing with the one in Las Vegas, the replica on the strip in Las Vegas. They darkened that. You know, it just reminds me of a couple of quick things here. One, you know, it's the relationship between the Americans and France, even though at times it's been testy politically in recent years. You know, you go back to the foundings of America and the Battle of Yorktown, when the French Navy blocked the British Navy at Yorktown Harbor from getting assistance into the British troops, and that allowed the Americans to win the battle and subsequently the war for independence. You look at both World Wars, World War I and World War II. Don't forget the Statue of Liberty in New York is a gift from the government of France. I believe that was from 1886, and they brought this large statue over from France, and they installed it, you know, in New York. And then we got World Wars I and II, and we've gone over and liberated France in World War II. And you see all the French. I still see video and still photos of the French folks who were lining the streets as our service members 70 years ago were marching down the street, and you see all the Viva la France signs, and the people were just happy that they were no longer under Nazi rule. And then after the 9/11 attacks 14 years ago, you know, the French, they had paid their tributes to the Americans when we were under time of duress. So we've had a long-standing relationship with the French people, and so we do support them during this time of need against a common enemy. Moving on, we have had a recurring guest on our show, and that is James Carson from Xcel Energy, and he is here with us today to discuss the latest with Xcel Energy's proposed rate increase. But before we bring Jim on, we're going to show you a video put together by ARP, American Association for Retired Persons.
Xcel has come to the Public Utilities Commission with a request to raise rates over a multi-year period. It's the first time in the history of the state that it's been more than a single-year request. By 2016, that would be $123 extra on your bill as a result of this increase. If this is approved and if it goes into effect, it'll be the seventh time that customers have seen their rates increase since 2005. Part of this proposal, this request from Xcel Energy, is to increase that customer charge. And that's money that you pay before you ever flip the switch, before you ever use any electricity. Certainly puts a lot of burden on people who can't afford another utility rate hike.
Utilities are a huge impact when it comes to our financial planning, whether it's water, electricity, heat. They're a big percentage of our financial costs as a couple that's retired. Utility rates right now are in a position where those that can least afford it, those on fixed incomes, the older people, who actually have a tendency to use less energy, actually get hit harder. It's going to start to impact the quality of life, and if the rates continue to increase, you know, where do you cut back? You only have so many options. It really does make an impact, you know.
The raise that they're talking about, a 12% or $123 a year, I think it's absolutely insane. I think it's so unfair that this happens. Being on a fixed income, we don't get any more money, and all the utilities keep going up. So it really makes it pretty hard. Some of the things I've had to let go is the socializing and going places and traveling, because now I have to kind of limit myself because my money has to go for the daily expenses. I don't think that the general public is aware that we can do something about this.
If people are concerned about the impact of a $123 annual increase in utility bills, then they have an avenue to express their opinions. And that avenue is our Minnesota Public Utilities Commission. Just last year, when Xcel Energy came in for their rate increase, thousands of customers spoke out, and as a result, their request was slashed by 60%. It takes the time to go to a website, send an email, pick up the phone, make a phone call, write a letter to the editor. The reality is Xcel provides a very important and critical service that we all rely on. Our job is to push back and to share our stories and make sure that the rate increases are fair and that we're not paying one dime more than we should be.
And so that is a little clip from ARP regarding the pushing back on Xcel Energy rate increase, and that came out about a year ago. And with us today, we have James Carson from Irisquan Energy with us again. Thanks for joining us, and I wanted your feedback on what's going on with Xcel. And also, I know that the video is about a year old, so do you have any information on more modern numbers?
Yeah, they're looking to increase rates considerably. I think it's amounts to 10%. Or a little more than that, 12%, over the next 3 years. There was a change at the legislature, I believe it was the last session, that allows them to ask for multi-year rate increases. That's new. Before it used to be year at a time. Now they're using that this time so that they can do, it's more long-term planning. I don't particularly have any reason to oppose that because their planning cycle is much longer than 1 year. It's a little much longer than 3 years. However, I'm questioning whether this rate increase is warranted, or at least I want to know a lot more about why this rate increase is going to be happening. If you think about what's been going on in the energy sector over the past 7-8 years, since 2008, prices for oil, natural gas, coal, everything have fallen dramatically. Not power.
And I think
especially retail power, it has on the wholesale market. Since 2008, the wholesale prices for electricity in Minnesota have fallen from over 6 cents to under 2.5.
Wow.
It's a humongous decrease of more than 50%, well over 50%. And that's about 4 cents or three and a half cents. Why have we not? I mean, Xcel Energy should be looking, should be asking us, or should be begging us not to cut rates. There's no, I don't see any justification for increasing rates. Now, when we take a look at the rate case, when they bring it forward, I think what we'll see is that it's going to be warranted, that there's going to be a, they're going to be able to justify a significant increase. The question in our mind should be why? What is driving the costs to go up? And I think that they're talking about things like capital investment in transmission, distribution, things like that. Well, why are we investing so much more in this, in these transmission distribution services and the, and so on? Mm-hmm. We're not, the population is not growing. It's, we're not opening new communities or things like that. What we're doing is we're accommodating new forms of generation on the grid, wind and solar in particular, especially wind. It's very expensive to serve, to bring the energy from the wind generators to the market, to the
Does the recent activity with the Sherco plant have anything to do with that? I'm not sure what's going on up there, but I've heard it in the news.
Yeah, sure. Sherco is this essentially three generators. They just repowered one of them to from coal to natural gas. They, Xcel was talking about repowering the other two generators from coal to natural gas or clean coal or something. It was not, not a, now they decided to simply close them and go to one generator. And basically they're talking about using wind as this, as this, as the solution. I think that's not, that's incredibly irresponsible of them to do that. Wind is, does not meet the needs we have in this state for reliability. The power goes out, a lot of bad things happen in Minnesota, especially in the wintertime. And we can't count on the wind to be there when we need it there. That's why it doesn't count as capacity. Getting back to the issue of the rate increase, when you take a look at your bill and the price you're paying, it's really made up of four or five things. First is energy costs, and that's the wholesale energy costs that I was talking about that has fallen so much. Then there's capacity costs. Capacity in Minnesota until recently has been very cheap. It's about to go up because the there's an emerging shortage of generation in Minnesota because of the retirements and also because of just, you know, it just it's crossing the line. Third thing would be transmission, which is the big towers you see, and then distribution, which is the neighborhood stuff, and then you have admin, which is you know, the golf memberships and stuff like that, and the cost of doing business. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't see a whole lot of cost drivers going on there, except for the fact that we are now doing a lot more to accommodate green energy. And I want to see them tell us in specific terms how much this green is costing us. Xcel says that the wind generation is cheap. I think they're mistaken, and that the CEO of Xcel Energy has said that, and I came out of my chair when I heard him say it, because it's not true. It's very expensive.
So for the proposed rate hike, what is the process that the utility has to go through in order to get it approved?
Well, they have to submit their case to a rate case to the Public Utility Commission. Then there's a period of comments and discussion and going back and forth, and different interest groups like ARP get involved. Different industry groups get involved too, because electricity is a major cost for them. Mm-hmm. And so on. One of the things that I think you're going to start seeing is that it's going to start driving people, especially industry, who are energy intensive, away from Minnesota. We have had one of our only advantages has been our electricity costs have been average to below average. Now they're starting to creep to being above average across the country. And that's going to start affecting the business climate here adversely. So, you know, seniors are looking at our total bills. They're saying, "Geez, that power is creeping up. It's an extra 10 a month from here. Is that going to force me to, you know, sell out in Minnesota, move to Arkansas, or move to, you know, Florida or wherever?"
The ARP video. What's your that we just seen? What your observations? Your thoughts?
I think they're on point. I think they have an interest group, you know, seniors, which I'm close to becoming that group. They're interested in making sure that their interests are served and that the price increases are not warranted. I think that they're mistaken or missing the point in not going drilling into the why and the cost drivers. It certainly isn't the cost of energy. The energy portion has dropped significantly. We should be looking, again, we should be looking at at price decreases. On a per kilowatt hour basis, the cost has fallen by 3 cents a kilowatt hour or more than that. It's actually more than 3 cents. Why are they increasing prices at this stage? There's no justification for it that I can see.
All right. Well, thank you for stopping by, Jim. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. Thanks for having me on.
You're welcome. And we had Veterans Day last week, and I wanted to take a moment to mention that I was kind enough to get a $5 coupon from Applebee's, as well as a free haircut coupon from Great Clips. And yes, I do need a haircut, so I think that's where I may be going after the show. And the biggest thing is that it's just on Veterans Day, I'm really appreciative of seeing the businesses that support our veterans at this time. I mean, I remember growing up, there used to be years where, you know, it was just a school celebration, and then that would be about it, but it wouldn't really be, you know, that much more than that. And now we're seeing the business community really become a driving force. The veterans, myself included, really feel honored and appreciated by that. And we hope to, well, I guess as a veteran, I just want to say thank you if you are a business owner or work for a business that provides a Veterans Day benefit to veterans, because it is really appreciated. And I also want to make mention that we had the 40th anniversary of the Edmund Fitzgerald sinking was on Tuesday, and I was up at Split Rock Lighthouse in northern Minnesota. It's about 45 minutes north of Duluth, and it was a really nice ceremony. I took shot some video. I have not had time to process that, but I hope to be able to get that to you next week. But we did have a storm, and if our producer can put up the map real quick, I'm going to show you briefly a map of Lake Superior, and there it is. This is from marinetraffic.com. We had that storm that came in on Wednesday night, and it was eerily reminiscent of the one that occurred in 1975 with the sinking of the Edmund Fitzgerald. We had a strong low pressure system that came out of the southwest and through Colorado, and it made its way through the Midwest and into the Great Lakes. At the same time, there was another low pressure system coming from Canada, going from the southwest to the northwest to southeast, and those two systems almost collided, which is not unlike what happened back then, 40 years ago. But thankfully, I was monitoring marinetraffic.com, the website you see here, and each of these green dots represents a vessel. And the American Integrity I have highlighted here, that's heading for Superior, Wisconsin. The Walter J. McCarthy, that's heading to Burns Harbor, wherever that is. We got Crooked Creek on the is the American Courage destination. So the Michipicoten, that is heading for Two Harbors, and that's the position 3 minutes ago. And it was interesting to see all of the ships on this interactive map all huddled into port. And you kind of wish that this technology would have existed 40 years ago to see exactly what was happening with the Great Lakes ore fleet that particular night. As a matter of fact, right here over by Mackinac Island, Michigan, you have the James R. Barker. I actually saw that vessel pull into Duluth the other night, Wednesday night. And so that's its present location. So this marinetraffic.com interactive map is really unique tool in the modern era. And, you know, again, we just look at what life was like on the Great Lakes, and we don't forget that even though we have a strong El Nino this year, which usually brings us mild weather, that storms like this do occur, and they occur with regularity, actually, on a cyclical basis. So that was this week, and I guess we got our young intern, Andrew. he is in here and he's got something special. What in the world are you doing, Andrew? And so we have, is that a birthday cake? And yes, it is a cake. That is our first year anniversary. It's actually 1 year ago tomorrow we started this, our first episode of the show. And so we have a 1 year birthday cake. Well, thank you guys. Wow. So I guess, do I have to make a wish and blow out the candle? Okay, well, I'll wish for a another good year of health for my entire staff and crew, and for another good year of viewership from viewers like you. Oh, I failed. Yes, we appreciate the fact that you've stuck with us for a year. We took over the show from Tony Hernandez. He had the show for 2 years, and then he was vacating the chair, and then our producer, Dallas, had asked me to step in, and we decided to just rebrand the program, and this is the product. And so I was tapped as the host, and from there, we've had a pretty good year. We interviewed some really great people, got a chance to see some unique things, participate in a couple of unique protests. But yeah, it's 1 year that we've started the show, so I guess here's to another year. And speaking of Tony Hernandez, I actually had a chance to sit down with him yesterday and discuss what's going on in his life. Started the show. This is our first anniversary of our first week, and this show originated out of the old Tony Hernandez show, and he and Tony had held the captain's chair for the previous 2 years, and so we just figured today, being the one year anniversary of North Star Oasis, that we would bring on Tony Hernandez once again.
Jeff,
Tony,
it's great to be here. Again. Hello, Minnesota.
And I wouldn't call it old. I'm not old. I'm not that old.
Well, you're 365 days older.
Yeah, we do have some great news since the last show. Is Leona and I have been busy, and we're expecting our second child to be born in April. So,
oh, congratulations!
We had some hardship. I shouldn't say second child. We lost a child to a miscarriage and then an ectopic pregnancy, and so we just, you know, Leona did a bunch of things with diet and met with a bunch of great doctors, and they did some great treatments that are all in line with like pro-life teachings, and it's a miracle. We're expecting Max to be a big brother very soon. So.
Well, I'm really glad to hear that.
And Leona says hi, and Maximilian says, oh, hello, hello. He's talking more, so he wishes he could be here, though.
Well, eventually he'll be, you know, the next Hernandez to sit in the chair of the studio, right?
I hope so. Maybe someday. He is somewhat of a ham, that's for sure. He likes to talk to people, too, so.
So other than that, and that's good news, what have you been doing in this last year?
The last year, I've just had my head down, and I've been working a lot. The real estate finance market has been pretty strong. A lot of people are buying houses, and so I've just had my head down, sitting at my desk, originating mortgages, closing deals, and trying to make money in this new world economy that we have going on here. Trying to stack away money, too, because you never know what's going to come around the corner. There's still so much uncertainty with the economy, but this last year was good. So it's we have an old saying is make hay when the sun's shining.
That's right.
And that's what I've been trying to do.
Well, good. A year ago, as you were wrapping up the show, every time you would come onto the studio, you would usually have the paint on your hands from the day's work.
Yep.
You still have paint going on, or have you moved on to other house projects?
No, the painting's done. We got most of the flooring done. I've been focusing a lot. I got a chainsaw about a couple months ago. So I've been doing a lot of just tree removal, brush removal, getting rid of old
Protect
branches.
Protect those fingers.
Yeah. Yeah, we have. I try to practice safety, but it's an amazing, amazing machine, the chainsaw is. Loud too, so I try to remember to wear my earplugs because if you don't, your ears will be ringing afterwards.
That's right.
But yeah, the home improvement stuff is going, it's going pretty well. I'm just trying to finish the bathroom. That's my nemesis. I don't like being in there. Such a compact space.
Yep.
Every time I want to work on it, Max's room is right next to it. It seems like he's sitting down for a nap or going to bed for the night. And so, but almost done with that.
So during the 2 years that you hosted your show, do you have any moments that stand out in your mind that you
There was a lot of moments. I miss the show. I miss working with Dallas. He's a great producer. He is a workhorse.
He's somebody best producer I've ever been involved with.
Completely committed to this show, and he was to our show, and I certainly miss that. But we had a lot of great guests on our show too. I think one of our first guests was State Senator Roger Chamberlain.
Yeah.
He was on the show. I remember we had the Minnesota Republican Party candidates chair debate on our show, where we had the four different candidates.
That's right.
And then we had the vice chair, but the deputy chair candidates as well show up for that. We had school board candidates. We had Democrats, David Martinez, Chu Vu, who went to go on to win the St. Paul School Board election. He's a Democrat, but he was a great candidate. We appreciated him going on the show. And we just had tons and tons of great guests. State Representative Mary Franson, she was on. Jake Duesenberg and his, who's now one of the leaders of the Minnesota Tea Party Alliance, very outspoken. He's made the news a couple times with some of the statements that he's made about certain politicians out there. But yeah, it was all about the guests. That's what I loved the show, is every week we had a new great guest on and who could offer some type of insight or create controversy or whatever it was.
Other than the producer, what do you miss most about it?
Other than missing Dallas, again, it was the guests. It was every week having a new guest to sit down and talk with and to gain their perspective and to share that with the audience. That was probably the most fun part of it by far.
Do you ever look at getting back into television again at some point in the future?
I would like to. It's hard in Minnesota to find that balance where you can do it and make a living and still provide for family. But it's something that I have in the back of my head, because I just enjoyed it so much. And so I guess I would be, open to doing that again in the future.
And then your thoughts on the upcoming presidential election, since we're only, I think it's 59 weeks away.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of excitement, which I think is great. I mean, locally, I live in the 2nd Congressional District, so I'm definitely going to be observing very closely and trying to figure out who to support in that race. The candidates are, that's one where Jason Lewis is running, and Pam Myra is running, John Howe. David Gerson's running for a second time. He challenged Congressman Klein in the first one. And then it seems like there's a couple strong Democrats running. So we definitely need to make sure that we keep that seat in conservative hands, because it's not a give-me seat. It's not John Klein had to run three times in order to win that district.
Yep.
So it's not just a given Republican. Went for President Obama last year or during the presidential election last time. He won that district, so it swings both ways. But the presidential race has been very interesting. I like Dr. Ben Carson a lot. I like Senator Marco Rubio. I think that Donald Trump is serving his purpose. I really like the fire that he's putting against Jeb Bush. No offense to Jeb Bush, but I do agree that he's a low-energy candidate, and we really have to be careful, because presuming that Hillary Clinton's going to be the nominee, we have to look at our candidates as who can beat Hillary. And I don't think that Jeb Bush can beat Hillary Clinton. I'm not quite sure even Marco Rubio would be able to beat Hillary Clinton, although they have a better mixture. But we better put somebody up who can win. I think that's going to be very important. But then secondly, that's actually going to deliver on some key issues that a lot of the people of the center-right want to see change, like tax reform, getting rid of some of these onerous regulations that are kicking good jobs out of not only Minnesota but our country, and then balancing trade. I think that Donald Trump is right that foreign leaders are making mishmash with our leaders in terms of debate and some of these deals, these so-called free trade deals that go on, that I don't think are in our favor, and they're more in favor of those who want more of an equal or net zero type trade situation globally.
And then your thoughts about Bernie Sanders as a candidate?
Bernie, I think he's kind of like Donald Trump in a way. Like, he's serving his purpose for the people on the left. I was driving in St. Paul. I saw a lot of Bernie signs out there, the red, white, and blue ones. I think that Hillary Clinton, when they were debating, you know, his anti-capitalist stance is pretty ridiculous. And I did actually like that Hillary called him out when he was saying that we should be more like Sweden and Denmark. And she's like, well, those countries just have a few, you know, million people in their population, whereas the United States has over 300 million. You can't compare them. We're a superpower. They're not. Mm-hmm. So why would us, superpower nation, why would we want to emulate countries that are not superpowers? It doesn't make any sense. And so, you know, I think that that will help some of his followers who are so solidified to the socialist cause. Maybe it'll poke some holes in their doctrine, in their doctrinal beliefs, to so that they can see the light on free market capitalism for what it is. But, you know, I like that there's starting to become a distinction between like state-controlled capitalism or crony capitalism and true free market enterprise, because there is a big difference there. And I think that Americans need to hear about that.
And then, are you going to be watching the debate tonight? The Democrats are having another debate.
No, I don't think I'm going to watch it, just because I have better things to do. They're not that exciting. I watched the last one, and it was like a bunch of old senior citizens. Nothing against senior citizens, but you know, they're talking about white privilege when their entire stage is filled with people who have benefited from white privilege. It makes no sense to me, and it literally, like, I don't have the time for it. Are you gonna watch it?
Not sure yet.
Dallas, do you watch it, or do you?
Oh, don't? Yeah, I tuned in and record them all.
You do, huh? Interesting.
So, well, with that, any last minute words that you have for the viewers?
No, I just will. Tell me about more about your show. I mean, how do you think the first year has gone? Are you happy with it?
Oh, I'm happy with the first year. I think we, you know, it's always a time of transition when you're taking over from an old host and your new host. And since the host, me, hasn't done television in like 20 years prior to getting back into it, you know, it was an adjustment for mainly throughout December and into January. And then I got the feel for things. We started structuring the show a little bit better, and we try to run everything around a common theme. We were at Bernie Sanders' big deal in November and April when he was here. We've covered Rafael Cruz and Rand Paul when they were here, Rafael being Ted Cruz's father. We brought on Roger Chamberlain, Keith Hardy, Jim Carson. We've had some really good guests this year. We also brought the cameras out into the community, cut a lot of community activities and events. Nice. And then we've also played to my strong suit of history. And so we put a good blend together, and I'm really happy with the way the show has evolved in this last year.
Good. Well, yeah, sorry for outdressing you again. I know we always talked about that.
You know,
before,
we always talked about outdressing.
I didn't know if I should wear my tie or my fleece. I couldn't decide.
Yeah, I've always said that the biggest thing is that I want the guest to shine, not so much the host. At this point in time, whenever I have guests, I'd much rather have, you know, be underdressed and let the guest overdress, and that way it just makes the guest, in this case you, look better.
Well, I appreciate that, and hey, best of luck for this upcoming year.
Thank you, Tony, appreciate it, and welcome back.
Sounds good, thanks, Jeff.
Well, that was our look back with Tony Hernandez, the previous host of our show, and I usually mention the fact, and I'm glad that Tony brought up his analysis of the presidential race, because I usually do a countdown, and there are only 61 weeks and 5 days left until the next presidential inauguration. And we are now down to the last, less than 1 year, I think it's like 364 days left until the next presidential election. So this presidential election contest is going to be very important, especially when you have an open seat and both parties are grappling very, very hard to try to get the seed into their hands. And that's going to have long-term consequences for all of us, regardless of which party gets elected, which candidate gets elected. The fact is the presidency is a very big deal, and that's one of the reasons we've spent a lot of time this last year focusing on the presidential election to make sure that the people can, that everybody gets a chance to see the... Hold on one second here. I was asked to show something on the screen, and this is where I get my information from on how many weeks that we have left. Is President Obama's retirement day calendar. It's at timeanddate.com. So there's 61 weeks, 5 days, 18 hours, 24 minutes, and 13 seconds. Oh, and there goes down to 10 seconds, so it's counting it down. The thing about focusing on what we call President Obama's retirement day is the fact that it is the inauguration. And I would, and my staff and I agree that if we focus more on the inauguration, we're looking at the peaceful transition of power. If we focus on the election, then you're getting into the highly charged political rhetoric from both sides. And what we're interested in looking at is that peaceful transition of power. And that's why, you know, hey, the president's retiring. So that's why it's his retirement day. And if you go back to when the 2008 election, that was President Bush, George W. Bush's retirement day in January 20th, 2009. And then you can go back to January 20th, 2001. That was President Obama. President Clinton's retirement day. So, you know, the retirement day, you know, seems to fit the mantra. And what we're trying to get across this, on this show is education and giving you an opportunity to make an enlightened choice. And I guess that when, I remember this now, in 2001, when George W. Bush was coming into office, the Clinton administration had removed all the W keys on the keyboard. So now, the question is, in 61 weeks, 5 days, 18 hours, 22 minutes, and 30 seconds, what is President Obama's administration going to do? Is there going to be something, you know, cute like that, or is it going to be dignified? And I really would bet that it's going to be more dignified, because if you look, George W. Bush, he helped in that transition, and... and got a lot of help. Just a different attitude than the Clinton administration. I bet that the Obama administration is going to be more like that and actually help in that transition. But we'll find that out in 61 weeks, 5 days, 18 hours, 22 minutes, and 1 second. So with that, I also bring up the fact that we have 40 days left until Christmas. 40 shopping days left until Christmas. And then, of course, we have today is the birthday cake, followed up with my haircut at the Great Clips, thanks to their generosity. And then we do have one more clip that we're going to show you, and that is our year in review. We did a lot of things this year.
So, Pam, can you tell us about the history of Life Prep Academy?
Well, the history, first of all, in concept, has been at least a decade in the making. I've been a teacher for 28 years, and throughout the years, at different times, seeing a need for kids who are in high school who were high-risk kids. I worked at Lino at the juvenile center there, and I would see kids who would intentionally sabotage themselves when they were coming off probation, and just because they knew where they were was a good place for them, that they were safe, they had people who cared about them, and it just didn't make sense that, you know, kids should have to commit a crime in order to be in a setting, you know, that's good for them.
Christmas, you could buy stuff at Menards on sale, and mm-hmm. everybody's ideas are getting bigger and bigger, and then, of course, the Canadian Pacific. They have their holiday train that goes around and collects food across the country, both countries actually. And one day he was talking about, that's pretty cool, you know.
So was that this year?
Oh, no.
Or a couple of years ago?
That's probably 10, 12, 6?
Started in 06, 2006.
So
when did you actually start working on the train?
2006.
Yeah. So when did you finish the train?
It's still continuing.
Okay.
I'm trying to add a new car to it every year. So
what was the new car you added this year?
This year, it might not make the run yet. It might be at the beginning of next year.
Okay. What are you working on?
The new car got quite complicated. The new car will have sound in it, playing Christmas music with flashing lights, light sequence to the music. So
now, do you guys go out and see the train every time it comes in, now that you've got the model railroad train? See if there's anything
actually else. I think they come here and see what we're up to.
Yeah.
So that train didn't change very much over the years, and then all of a sudden when he started building the train, I noticed they started doing a lot more with their train too. So they just had, you know, a series of lights on it. I'm you know, there's probably at least some degree of truth to that.
But there could be.
I'm going to read out of today's Star Tribune. The package also includes Markhart's, that's Representative Paul Markhart, who you just heard speak. He has not yet introduced bill to separately increase railroads' property taxes by assessing rail cars, trestles, and rail bridges. That would raise $45 million annually for municipal governments, but not necessarily for rail safety. So is this just another way of assuming funds into the general fund from a source? I think so. I think that the railroads would probably be more apt to agree to that, and I think, you know, even Republicans would be more apt to agree if it was set aside for the rail safety improvements. But no, this is just another raid to get tax money, another excuse to raise taxes. Railroads are not on board with Dayton's plan, the article continues. The BNSF Railway, the top oil hauler out of North Dakota with 1,584 miles of track in Minnesota, said it opposes the measure, which I don't disagree with them on. Quote, we believe the proposed changes are in direct violation of federal law because they single out railroads for discriminatory taxation, BNF spokeswoman Amy Macbeth said in an email. And that was something that happened earlier this month. The United States Navy Reserve turned 100 years old. The reserve was created in March of 1915, and there was a ceremony that was held up at, I think this is at the... I'm not even sure. Our producer, Dallas Pearson, he actually went there. I was working that day. So anyhow, I'm going to show you the tribute, the ceremony that went on with the Navy Reserve 100th anniversary.
Navy Operational Support Center, Minneapolis, arriving. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our ceremony celebrating the 100th anniversary of the Navy Reserve. I am Lieutenant Michael Sheehan, a Reserve Public Affairs Officer with U.S. Fleet Forces Command in Norfolk, Virginia, and Lifeline. NOSC Minneapolis helps the nearly 700 Navy Reservists in Minnesota maintain their administrative, physical, and medical readiness necessary to perform their missions. Ladies and gentlemen, Commanding Officer of NOSC Minneapolis, Captain Brent McMurray.
Well, good morning, everyone. It is still morning, right? Okay. Thank you for coming out today. I know old, cold man winter is reminding us we're still here in March, but we certainly feel the warm welcome with the Minnesota civilians and leadership as we celebrate the 100th centennial of the Navy Reserves. I'd like to take this opportunity to just publicly welcome a few of our special guests. From Governor Dayton and
Well, Netanyahu came out just before, as the Bloomberg piece had mentioned, said that there will not be a Palestinian state in his tenure. Well, the thing, and yet he had previously said that, you know, there will be a two-state solution. And the thing is, considering that if he would have lost, he would have been right. If he would have lost, there would not have been a two-state solution in his term, because there's not a two-state solution going on now. And then, of course, in the next 4 years, if he, it's probably doubtful at this point that he'll run for a fifth term. But the thing is, in the next 4 years, is this actually going to happen? Probably not. So Netanyahu is not lying. He did not change his position. He did not change his mind, even though the Western press wants to make it sound that way, even though President Barack Obama wants to make it sound that way. The fact is, the same position that he's had has never changed. Now, wording may have changed just a slight little bit, but the meaning of the word still hasn't. But the biggest thing here, the biggest takeaway is the fact that, you know, President Obama failed in his initiative to defeat Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. That's another failure of the Obama administration. And really, the first failure, what was that first failure of the Obama administration? It was the Olympic Games, not landing the Olympic Games for 2016 in Chicago. This is when President Obama went to the Olympic, head of the Olympic Committee. He made his appeal, refreshed president who just received the Nobel Peace Prize, and they awarded it to Brazil. I wanted to show you my little guest today that I brought with me because I think it's time we take a look a little bit at reconciliation and healing. Right here, this is a bronze bust that was designed by Ed Dwight. Ed Dwight was the first black astronaut candidate, African-American, lives in Denver. He did not make it through the astronaut program, but he he's a prolific sculptor. In 2003, I was a photographer at the Tuskegee Airmen International Convention in Denver. And I won this bronze bust that Ed Dwight had designed. And I wanted to bring him in because, one, he's my first guest. But more importantly is the fact that when you look at what the Tuskegee Airmen did, these are the guys with the 332nd Fighter Group and the 477th Bombardment Group in World War II. It was the first black pilots that we had in this country. And what did they do? They protected they were the fighter escorts for the bombers that were coming through, the long-range bombers. A lot of white crews. There were some white crews who said, oh, I don't want to fly with these guys. Until they realized that these were the guys going in and doing the things that other white crews wouldn't do, bring them closer into the target. That their very safety hinged upon the Tuskegee Airmen. That's when they received acceptance. I had a chance to meet a lot of these fine gentlemen. I was at the at Coors Field with with one of the Tuskegee Airmen trainers, telling me all the stories about what they were doing at the Tuskegee Institute, pointing out the different people and saying, oh, this one used to do this. I remember running this guy's butt all around the track. Oh, this guy used to smart off to me, but, you know, oh, we corrected him in a hurry. Interaction between me and the EWO veteran.
Sand is just about the same color as your shirt, is there? Mm-hmm. That ain't no sand. It's black. Volcanic ash.
I got a question for you. Does that look familiar?
That's identical. That's what it is. I got a jar like that.
Yep.
That's what this.
You can go ahead and just pass this.
That's what the earth stands.
Do not open the lid. That is sand from Iwo Jima. Does anybody know?
And if we can go to camera one, here is the vial of sand from Iwo Jima. And as you saw, that the Iwo vet recognized it right off the bat. He's got a jar like this at home. Here is sand from Iwo Jima. Also, Kathy Werda, who's from Virginia, Minnesota, who actually works here at Apple Ford and Shakopee and is a member of the Southwest Metro Mustang Club. And so, Kathy, you're going to tell us about the 2015 Mustangs.
It's super fast, and it's like a Panther, and has the independent rear suspension, and it's an amazing car. I used to have Porsches, too, in the past, and it's like a combination of a Porsche and a Mustang. It's a true muscle car. I mean...
Well, now that this is the 50th anniversary of the Mustang, we looked at a 64 and a half model earlier, and now we're looking at the 2015. What can you tell us about the changeover in just technology and the way the Mustangs were and the way they are now?
Well, they shaved off 200 pounds on the new one, so it's a lighter. The engine they modified a little bit, so it's a lot more horsepower than the 13 and the 14s. They changed the suspension to be the independent rear suspension, and they put modes in there so you can change it from normal, sport, track, and wet and snow. Although I'm not driving mine in the snow, but rainy days, you're out on a cruise, flip it in the snow wet mode, and it actually goes a little slower, if you can believe that. And the track apps, and it has line lock, so you can lock up the front tires when you put the brake on, but it releases the back brakes, so you can do your burnouts in style.
So, Democrat in the 2016 presidential race. So right now we have Hillary Clinton, Martin O'Malley, and Bernie Sanders, and then I guess Lincoln Chafee has also joined the lineup on the Democrat side. And yes, Bernie Sanders is a self-avowed socialist. We'll get that disclaimer off the top. He isn't, but that also is a state of the way the politics has gone, and I'll talk more about that later. In the meantime, here is U.S. Senator Bernie Sanders at the American Indian Center in Minneapolis, 11 o'clock on last Sunday.
Well, here we are at the Bernie Sanders event in Minneapolis. We're just waiting for the senator to arrive right now. This is one of those rare moments on North Star Oasis when you get a chance to actually have a presidential candidate on the very week that we are actually talking about him. So here we are. We're just waiting, and let's find out.
Let me also apologize. We didn't have enough food. This is about 10 days ago. We said we're going to be in northern Iowa. Let's go to Minnesota, have a few people show up. We asked the SEIU if we could use their halls. They fined 200 people. That wasn't going to work. We came here. This is not big enough. We ran out of food. Our apologies. Next time we'll have enough food. Everybody, thanks very much. I have to say that we are off to a strong start in this campaign, a campaign which is calling for a political revolution in this country.
And with that, we are going to have a guest today, and I'm going to introduce Jim Carson from Risquant Energy. And Jim, welcome to North Star Oasis.
Good to see you again, Jeff.
So, that your impression of that video?
Great marketing. Very good. They're going to get hook a lot of people into investing into this clean energy collective concept.
Okay, so is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Depends on if you like money. If you want to make a good investment, I'd say you should take a much harder look at it than this video would suggest. It's not as attractive as it would appear. It only works to the extent that there are subsidies and mandates that support it.
So can you just give us a rundown locally as to what the whole community solar initiative is? Does that mean that if I just put a solar panel up in my backyard that I can tap into this, or is there a dedicated space for all of this?
Well, if you have a home that you want to put your solar panel on and so on, you can do that, and it basically is a behind-the-meter application, and you're allowed to do that. The utility is supposed to work with you on that sort of thing. Community solar, though, is where you take a larger installation, let's say on land that's otherwise not being put to good use, useless otherwise, and they build a large facility up to 1 megawatt. That's 1,000, 1 million watts or 1,000 kilowatts, depending on how you want to measure that.
So how big would that be as far as heating and lighting, the energy needs of a residential neighborhood? I mean,
my home uses a little more energy than average, and we use about 1 kilowatt per month, 1,000 kilowatt hours per month. So a megawatt is enough to do about 1,000, maybe 1,500 homes for a month.
So where are the results from all of the money that the governor has already appropriated?
Well, we're not getting it. You know, it's a long conversation. We can talk about it for weeks and hours and weeks. But there are very few results. You know, they keep doubling down on the same stuff. And this is a discussion I have with people all the time when they meet with me and I meet with them and the debates we have in committee is that, you know, let's do something that actually might change the equation and change the outcomes, because Minneapolis at 21,000 and St. Paul at 20,000 per student, we all know what's going on there. And it doesn't stop there. It goes beyond those borders. Some schools, successful schools are the exception these days. Our kids are being cheated all across the state on a daily basis. So the money he and others advocate throwing at the schools is to keep the teachers union happy, period. The other two bills he vetoed, he never had any inkling, he never gave anybody any idea that he was going to veto those bills.
And those were?
The ag environment and the jobs bill. So he vetoed those. He hadn't told anybody he was going to really veto those bills. So.
First is because of something else that was happening last weekend, and that happened right here in our own community in North St. Paul. They dedicated the brand new Veterans Memorial Park. And while one of us was over in Fort Snelling, we had another crew member over at North St. Paul, and here are some of the scenes that were shown. Move on to but we're actually going to go back in time right now. We were at Black Lives Matter protest last week. We had given you just a little bit of a clip as to what had gone on, but we didn't really have a chance to get everything out there. So we're going to just do the next segment here of just some different clips from the Black Lives Matter protest. Some of this is going to be.
I want y'all to say hell yeah. Black fair. And I know we have friends out here, ladies, gentlemen, boys and girls. There are also enemies out here with us. We must stay calm and ignore the bull. Everybody got that?
Yes.
Everybody got that?
Yes.
Thank you. I'm going to introduce you to our action captain. Or maybe not. Today we're going to have a peaceful protest, okay? We're out here doing Black Fair. For a lot of different
reasons. Can you hear
a lot of people want us to only be talking about police brutality. And that's one of the things we're going to be fighting for, to end that. But the big picture, right? We want everybody to focus on the big picture, which isn't the social injustices, right? The beginning of those social injustices are economic injustices that disadvantage Black people, that disadvantage other people of color.
And since we were at the fair, we did take some video, and let's show you. Well, we had a very Very busy year this past year, but it was a good year and met a lot of great people, had a lot of great analysis, had a few great guests. But that was our year in review. So now we start another year coming up. That's our show. We'll see you next week. North Star Oasis.